What is so unique about this? And so I decided to go out to Ferguson. I went to the Canfield neighborhood. There are literally hundreds of people who are out in the streets, very angry, very hurt. What they had seen, which is what I did not experience, is watching a dead body lay on the ground for 4.5 hours. I did not see that or experience that. And I would have to tell you, anytime there is a shooting at a school, you know, those young people are able to get counselors. In this circumstance, many of the people that I represented were never, ever able to have counselors or psychiatrists or psychologists to help them deal with the fact that they had seen a dead body lay on the ground in very hot weather for 4.5 hours. That evening when I was in the Canfield neighborhood, one of the things that we saw were no less than 40 police cars. We had dogs that were out. There were machine guns. I cannot even tell you what they were called, what they are called, but they're as long as a human body. And it was very reflective. If you took a snapshot of that evening, it was quite reflective of a picture you would see in black and white from 1964 or 1965. But it was 2014 on August 9th in Ferguson, Missouri. And people were very upset. People were very hurt. There was a young man who was killed who was totally unarmed, did not have a gun, did not have a knife, no weapons whatsoever. He was walking in the middle of the street and he was targeted by a police officer. And there are about three encounters these two had. One at the first engagement, which was the conversation. The second engagement, which was a battle between who's going to hold the police officer's gun in his car. And the third engagement, where Michael Brown was 30 feet away and he was shot. The officer in question, Darren Wilson, became the judge, jury, and executioner of a young man that was unarmed. On the next day, which was August 10th, there were people who were out in the streets at the police station, they're in the Canfield neighborhood, and they were very hurt. I witnessed so much anger. I never realized how angry people could get and the number of people who were angry and hurt. I remember seeing a little girl who had a pink t-shirt on, and she had a sign that she created that said that all of God's children are loved. And I saw her come from a very positive message to being very angry. In fact, this young 8-year-old had a couple of choice words to offer police officers throughout that day. There are young people who are in the streets. There are people who are what we call underground rappers, everyday people, and others who were out in the streets who were angry. They were chanting, and they were trying to just get this emotion out of their system, which was the appropriate thing to do. Around 3 o'clock on August 10th, there was a prayer vigil, and mostly clergy, of course, from different faiths. And they got into a circle on the property of the police station, and they were going through their prayer vigil. And then in the middle of the prayer vigil, they stopped, and one of the ministers said, "Get out the street, get out the street, you're embarrassing us." These clergy members were talking to these young people, some of which were rappers, some of which were 8 years old, some younger, some babies in carriages, and it became a generational gap of how are we going to express ourselves after the death of an unarmed man. And for weeks and months, there was a generational disconnect. I never mentioned who I was. I never mentioned my name. I never mentioned my position as a state senator. What I wanted to ensure is that the young people who were out, who were very frustrated, had the opportunity to speak and had the opportunity to engage in a very positive way. But what happened after that point was very different. On August 11th, we were all tear gassed, and we never expected it. We didn't know that in 2014, civilized people would be tear gassed. We're not in a third world country at all. And so we were on West Florissant, which is ground zero number one. And I had my intern with me, a young minister with me, and we were alongside a one-way street called North Winds Estates. And again, what I wanted to do was just what I did the day before, is to make sure that people have the opportunity to voice their opinions, to express themselves, but within the law, which means that I wanted to make sure they were on public property, not private property. I wanted to ensure that they were not saying anything that was inflammatory or seen as a threat by police officers. So I was there along with other people. I think from the very beginning, there was a disconnect, a cultural disconnect between police officers and the community in question. I mean, we're different. We're African American, we're Hispanic, we're a lot of different things. But most police officers are Caucasian white men. And there was always a difference between how people respond, how people speak, how people act. And that cultural sensitivity was never part of the outreach on behalf of police officers. And in the same vein, I will tell you, there are a lot of the protesters who didn't understand the rules that were set by police officers, regardless of how arbitrary they were at times. And so you had this frustration. So on August 11th, we are peacefully protesting. There are at least 150 young people that are out in the streets. You have to imagine this is summertime. School's about to start in a couple of weeks. And people are hot. They're at work. They're summer jobs. They're evening jobs. And so we're out on the street. No violence whatsoever, because I would tell you that I would totally leave if I felt like I was in a position where my safety was in a vulnerable position. And so I told my assistant, I told my intern, if you see police officers move, we're going to have to go, and we need to run to our cars. So I looked back, and I saw officers go into their bags, and they were taking out something that looks like this. I'm going to show it to you. Someone had to purchase this for me. But this is the gas mask I ended up having after being tear gassed on August 11th. Someone bought this for me because I couldn't breathe, as well as all of the constituents that I had. We were on that one-way street on August 11th, and we couldn't move our cars because it was a one-way street. And police officers said, go out the other way, go out the other way. Well, there was no other way. And the police officers that were on hand didn't realize that there was no other way. So every single time we would try to turn around and go out the exit, the only exit, they would shoot rubber bullets and wooden bullets and shoot more tear gas at us. In fact, there was tear gas. We were tear gassed for 3.5 hours that night. For 3.5 hours. I will tell you, in 2010, I went to Iraq. I was in the red zone. We were there as international observers, and we ended up being shot at by militants. We were in a bunker for 1.5 hours. That experience in Iraq does not equate to the 3.5 hours of incurring tear gas, rubber bullets, and wooden bullets on behalf of the Ferguson Police Department, St. Louis County Police Department, and oh, by the way, the Missouri Highway Patrol, of which, as a senator, we approve their budget every single year. So this was quite disturbing. And I will tell you, quite frankly, the next day, I didn't know how to deal with it. I was in the shower, and I just started crying. And I'm saying to myself, I can't believe that as a senator, I'm in a peaceful position, and I was just tear gassed alongside my constituents. I never thought that that would ever happen. And we did nothing, nothing whatsoever to receive that tear gas and those rubber bullets. I will go backwards with you. That night, as we were trying to get out of that neighborhood, about 10:30 at night, there was crossfire with St. Louis County Police, and I was on the main thoroughfare, and I was ducking down in my car because I didn't want to be hit by any gunfire. I mean, this is not a normal situation. In fact, let me go backwards for a second. Ferguson hasn't even had a shooting in the last 10 years. So this was when Mike Brown was shot and killed by Darren Wilson. It had been the first shooting that Ferguson had in like 10 years. And it was pretty scary. So as time went on, we were protesting every single day, 24 hours a day. Some of the stories that I recall were young fathers who are Caucasian, who so happened to have black sons. And they were out early in the morning, and I just didn't recognize, I never just thought about it, that white fathers are fathers to black sons. Duh. You know, we have to think about intersectionality here, and how people adopt and they have interracial marriages and all of that. And the father said to me, they said, you know what? I'm here on these streets for my black son. And I just had chills, you know? I had chills. We're dealing with a community that is separated by race and by income. The region of St. Louis is separated by race and income. And, you know, we talk about how can racial inequality continue? How does it exist in 2015? How does it exist in 2014? Well, it's different. It's different from the Jim Crow laws, which were very overt. Everyone knew a white-only water fountain was not for people who were of color. People knew that if you went to a restaurant, you may be served, you may not be served if you are African American. People knew that there were different accommodations for bathrooms, different accommodations for education. And after Jim Crow ended, institutional racism became different. It became exercised in a different way, in a vague way, in a non-transparent way, where you still don't have access to equal education, you still don't have access to quality housing, you still don't have access to having great jobs or getting promoted within a company for which you've worked for decades. I'm not confronting them with some of the biases that they had, and I was just going along to get along. As long as people like me, you know, why should there be a concern? You know, even though I went home at night knowing that someone tried to marginalize me, someone tried to degrade me, someone tried to demean me. And this is what happened within the institution of state government. The institution of state government has been racially biased for decades. And I said nothing. When August 9th happened, the only thing that I can think of is I don't want these young people who I am representing and I'm advocating to exercise those emotions in a very positive way. Young people from the very beginning, I mean, they were feeling everything. They wanted to know, if you just understand the mindset for a moment, if you grow up knowing you're going to be stopped by an officer, whether you're walking or in a car, and you know that you're probably going to lose your job because you were stopped by a police officer, that's not right. That's what's been happening for generations of people since Jim Crow. So not only are young people, the millennials, dealing with marginalization and targeting and harassment, but people who are my age, the next generation up, and then the next generation, up to our parents. My parent was from the 60s, but any generation after our parents, Generation X, Generation Y, the millennials, we have not had the opportunity to experience racial disconnection like we have in the last year, where we're understanding it. And the mindset, here's what's so crazy. What's so crazy is that we thought that this is normal. The actions by police officers, we thought that this was normal. The actions of our colleagues in the Missouri House and the Missouri Senate and state government, we thought that this behavior was normal. But it's not normal, because we were never treated as equals in the first place. But we thought it's normal that people demean us. We thought it's normal that people degrade us. We thought it was normal that people would second guess us. We thought that was normal and it's okay, but as long as we get along to get along, everything is okay. Well, it wasn't okay. And the veil was lifted on August 9th when Michael Brown was killed by a police officer who was totally undereducated on his responsibilities. And as I said, people have been out, and I'm sure you've seen the pictures, protesting, trying to express themselves in a good light. We ended up having some agitators who came from different places, different states. We had to self-police ourselves for a good amount of time to get those people out. But as we grew as a movement, we started getting extremists from the other side, the opposite side, the racist side, who decided to start targeting us and targeting myself included. There was a day where, it's completely separate from what I was doing, but there was a day where there were a group of men who were in a car with guns, and they were going into an apartment building right behind where my office was. And they weren't targeting anyone specifically, but the gunshots came in my direction. And I had no clue if they were meant for me or someone else. They ended up being meant for people who lived in that apartment building, but they were shooting in our direction where I was standing. And violence just since this has happened has gotten worse and worse in St. Louis, honestly. One of my colleagues, Jamila Nasheed, she's a state senator, she was stopped right outside of her house, and she's a gun-carrying person. She has a permit for a gun. That night, she did not have a gun, and there was a person who stopped her right outside of her house, and they were ready to kill her. And she said, look, do what you have to do. They ended up laughing at her and driving off, and she kept her car, she kept her life. Nothing happened, but violence has gotten worse. And one of the reasons, and I can't say this is the only reason, but one of the reasons why violence has gotten worse in the St. Louis metropolitan area is because young people feel as though they don't have a voice or a pathway or a way out in general. But the gift in this entire experience is something that Michael Brown gave us, is the ability to understand, the ability to think out things, the ability to question the process, and also the ability to question authority and ask the question, why are you putting arbitrary policies in place? One of those arbitrary policies that was put in place was a curfew. Like, who in this day and age has a curfew? Then they created another arbitrary rule, a 5-second rule. You cannot stand in place more than 5 seconds, which came out to be unconstitutional. I mean, I remember a time where police officers were looking up our license plate numbers. They started tracking people at their homes and at their jobs and telling them if they come out, then they would be arrested. The people who were on papers, there's this young white guy, his nickname is Wu. He's white, but he's like a undercover brother. You know, he's white, but he's really black. Y'all understand that. And so, in any case, Wu, who is on papers, was one of the active protesters for a very long time. Police officers found out where he lived. They went to his house and they beat him up. And they shot his foot with one of those rubber bullets. And they said, if you come back out, we're going to make sure that you're back in jail. There's another guy, Derek, who just got out of jail last February, a year ago from this month, and he was out on the streets protesting, and they targeted him, and they said, if you stay out here, we're going to arrest you. And he said, you know what? I'm not doing anything wrong. I've been in jail for 14 years, but I'm going to stand up for this movement. There are people, there's a young kid, he called me today, in fact, his name is Low Key, it's his nickname. And right a week before this incident even happened, his mom comes to him and says, if you can find someone else to be your guardian, I will give up guardianship because I don't want you anymore. So this movement, this Mike Brown movement, became a movement of people finding family, even though they were not blood related. So the young kid, Low Key, he's now 16, he started off at 15 when I met him, but Low Key lived on the streets in Ferguson with these guys who had been gang members. He was not a gang member himself, but they were gang members. And they only thought, like many young African-American men do, that they will only live until the age of 21. Most people will tell you, I can go against the police officers because I don't expect to live more than 21 years of age. And then I'm supposed to die. Somewhere along the way, many of these young people, which is one of the gifts that Michael Brown gave us, they started saying to themselves, you know what? There is life after 21 years of age. There is an opportunity. A lot of these young people have little kids, and now they're living. They're leaving the game. They're leaving their gangs in the game to take care of their young children. Now, you can't legislate that. You can't legislate changing people's lives for the better, from violence to safety. It's almost impossible to do. But that's what has happened. That's what has occurred. And so when I got this phone call from Low Key this morning, he's talking to me about how police officers are trying to put wraps on some of these individuals who've been protesting, like I told you about Wu. But there are some people who are relentless, and they're not going to stop protesting. And as a result, some police officers have said, well, we're going to put a case on you. And so there's this one gentleman, and specifically his name is Bud, and he has long dreadlocks, he has asthma, he has this big old gold tooth, and he seems like he's just a scary thing, but he's sweet as pie. Well, if you know him, and he was a gangster, if you know him, you would love him. But if you are a police officer in St. Louis County, he's the scariest thing in the world. But he's as sweet as pie. And so he has been getting out from under all of these wraps that police officers have tried to tag onto him. And he was in, he had to go to court today. The reason why I'm saying all of this is because everything didn't happen or just occur on August 9th. It's still happening. I mean, there's a woman, Heather, she's white. She's in a wheelchair. She's 40 years old. She's been an activist from the very beginning. She does live streams, and she's in a wheelchair. Her mom drops her off every single day to go protest peacefully, right? There's not much that Heather can do because she's in a wheelchair. Well, on the 6-month anniversary, there was a police officer who knocked her off her wheelchair. You hear what I'm saying? A police officer knocked her off her wheelchair. She was beaten, arrested, and had to go to the hospital. Now, what is someone in a wheelchair able to do who's live streaming? She can't curse at police officers because she's live streaming. She can't kick police officers because she's in a wheelchair. But because she is bringing truth to what is occurring still today in Ferguson, they targeted her as if she was an African American, but she's an ally of ours. And they took her camera, they erased everything out of her camera, as well as they did journalists. So on that night, there was a journalist who was working on behalf of HBO because they want HBO because they want to do a documentary. And this journalist was out there with his tripod, with his film, just like any journalist, if you're NBC, MSNBC, CNN, Al Jazeera, any of these different affiliates out there. He was filming as a journalist, and police officers took his camera and erased everything. They erased everything. So what they've done, essentially, is to take our phones when, if you don't have a special password on your phone, like I do that now, because they took my phone once. I'm not going to make the mistake twice. But they took my phone once. And they go through protesters' phones. Now, I only support and speak on behalf of peaceful protesters. I do not speak on behalf of violent people whatsoever. But I have to tell you, these peaceful protesters, what they have had to endure is a crime. They've had the First Amendment taken away from them. Many of them have not had due process whatsoever. And they've been in jail longer than 24 hours. And our state law says that you can only hold a person for 24 hours. They have called the employers of some of these protesters. There's some protesters who have lost their homes for this fight. Low-key, who I talked to you about earlier, he's still looking for a place to live. He's been living with another one of the protesters who's always out of town, and he needs some structure in his life. He hasn't even seen his mother. He hasn't talked to his mother whatsoever. I mean, this is the real deal. This is not pretend. None of what we're going through is pretend. And there are people who are in our communities who choose to stay silent. There are a lot of people in my community where I live. It's half white, half black. It's working class and very comfortable. And there are people who I've known for years, who I've shared dinners with, who I've gone on walks with, who I've campaigned with, who are totally silent, as if Ferguson never occurred. They're thinking, well, Ferguson is 10 miles from my house, so nothing's going to happen here. Well, anytime there are a group of people who are disenfranchised, at some point, it's going to be on your front door step. It's going to be at your front door, knocking on the door, hitting you in the face, saying, there is discrimination that exists in this world, and it's time for you to say and do something. And it's not new to me, because I've had threats before. I've had a sticker, a crosshair sticker, put on my nameplate in my office. I've had someone sit outside of my house with a rifle, with a shotgun. I've had people protesting outside my house when I was fighting on behalf of immigration laws, progressive immigration laws. I had a person threaten my life. So it's nothing new to me to be threatened. However, because I was on the streets and I was advocating for the voice of these young people and making sure that they would be able to demonstrate in a peaceful manner and they were not victims to arbitrary rules, I became a target. Not only a target for extremists on our side, but for extremists on the other side, as well as police officers. And I was unwilling to get into a compromised position, being arrested or being beaten or anything happening to me. So I chose to change up what I did, and I started teaching civic engagement classes, which was really, really, really awesome. And a lot of my constituents didn't know who their aldermen were, who their city councilors were. They didn't know who their mayor was. And so I would talk to them about having an engaged conversation with their locally elected officials. And at some point, people would ask, are they really going to change their ordinances if we speak up? Many of these people didn't even know how to write a bullet point briefing. Like, if they were going to speak at city council, they didn't know that they should have a script. They didn't know that if you show your anger, people are not going to take you seriously. I had to teach all of that. Like, you can be very firm, you can have some emotion, but if you are irate, just all out irate, people aren't going to listen to you. And so I had to talk about these very elementary things. Being a politician, you know this you know this stuff. You can't speak to everyone the same. There's some people where you have to have a little bit of a temper. There are other people where you have to be completely, subdued in your conversation. And my constituents felt as though that elected officials just do what they want to do, and they don't have to be accountable for what the rest of the community wants. And so that's what I was teaching, is civic engagement. From that class, one of my constituents ended up having a building donated to them for young people. They're going to have a youth center. They have a lot of the services provided for them for free. The electrical cost of the building that was given to them is at least $28,000. And that work, that labor was donated to them so that they can have this facility. We're still trying to figure out our way in all of this. There are people who are still in the streets. I will tell you that law enforcement and others have gone to the furthest extent to quiet down what's going on. We know that the DOJ, Department of Justice, they are going to be coming out with a report. From what I read in the New York Times today, much of what they're talking about is municipal court reform. We have a problem here in St. Louis where people who are minorities are stopped more often and then have to go through the court process, and many people don't get their notices. But I have to remind as many people as possible that municipal court reform has absolutely nothing to do with why Michael Brown was killed. In fact, let's just be very clear about this. There is a certain level of cultural insensitivity. So one of the things that I talk about often is cultural competency. A lot of people talk about having representative police departments. Well, that's fine and dandy. However, if you don't have adequate training and education of police officers, you can have a black police officer who chokeholds a protester. In fact, that happened. There is a protester, Joshua Williams, who was chokeheld by a police officer who happened to be black. So even though you have a representative police department, it doesn't mean that you're not going to be targeted and harassed. So that education piece is really important. I think where we are going, we have a choice. We have a choice of confronting the issues that we're dealing with every single day, or we have the choice of living in two worlds, the tale of two cities. You could have two meetings right on the main thoroughfare on Ferguson, on Florissant Road. One meeting, there are a bunch of Caucasian folks who are like, we love Ferguson and there's nothing wrong whatsoever, let's just raise money. And then you have a group of people who are angry about the things that are happening to them. So people aren't being open. They're not talking amongst themselves about the differences of opinion. And I have to be the first person to say, if you have any bias whatsoever, let it out. Let people know what your biases are. Just be clear about it and be honest about it. But what I'm afraid of is that there's such an all-out effort to quiet down this movement. Ferguson really represents the entire nation. And why Ferguson is different is because it's still part of the South. Missouri is still part of the South. Missouri was a half free, half slave state. And it's not New York. You know, in New York, you're gonna change because of Eric Garner, that case, which was videotaped. It's going to have a huge difference. It's going to make a big difference when it comes to legislation. But in Missouri, we don't have that opportunity. So it is reflective of the South. It's reflective of Alabama. It's reflective of Mississippi. And so people are looking at Ferguson as if it is a Selma. There was no Bloody Sunday like Selma, but you literally had white and black folks who were targeted, who were tear gassed. I mean, for doing absolutely nothing. But exercising their right to vote, or not right to vote, but exercising their right to speak out. Even when you listen to the mayor, we had a hearing a couple of weeks ago, And he came to talk about the fact that we didn't have the National Guard the night of the announcement at Ground Zero. And the building where I was teaching was burned down, as well as other buildings that were burned down, and we'd have to deal with that. But if you listen to his words, he would say, "We're just trying to get them to go away. We're trying to get them to go away." Well, people who are protesting peacefully and rightfully on public property, they don't have to go away.
Right.
And so he speaks in terms of they need to go away. Well, he can't dictate who goes, and no one else can dictate who goes. They can only dictate whether or not people are peaceful. I mean, if you're peaceful, you can stay there all day long. It could be in sub-zero weather, and you can be protesting as long as you want to, as long as you're peaceful. And so the saga continues. I mean, this is just 2 weeks ago. They look at protesters as, "You're not supposed to be here. You're not supposed to be, you know, saying that you have a problem. Why can't you people," code word, "why don't you people just go do something and just deal with the situation that you're given?" Well, this is the wake-up call. We're not. The younger generation, they're not going to give up. None of us are going to give up. I have to do my thing here at the state and try to pass some laws so that we have a better definition for deadly force. We have cultural competency. We have mandated body cameras for police officers. It's what I have to do. But the reality is that there are a lot of people who are out there who are silent, or a lot of people out there who don't want to make any changes whatsoever. The status quo is just fine. And the status quo is not, because it's harming not only the state of Missouri, but our country. And if you saw what we were able to accomplish, our people around the nation who are willing to stand up and speak out about the differences in the way that they're being treated. There is a genocide going on. You can be brown, you can be black. And there is a state-authorized effort to kill people every day, every 28 hours. There is an unarmed brown, a black man that is killed every 28 hours. And it's authorized, it's legal to kill unarmed people. You obviously know what happened in California this week. You obviously know what happened in other places. There are people who are homeless and being killed. You know, who has ever thrown a pebble and then you get killed? Walk down the street and then you get killed. You go into your car, I'm sure you saw that North Carolina video. You're trying to get your wallet and then you're shot at by a police officer because he thinks you're getting a gun. You know, there is an all-out effort to ensure that there's a certain segment of this population that is going to be targeted and killed. And it's unfortunate. And so there's a bigger conversation that has to be had. And that's why it's so important that we have allies who look like everything and come from every different segment of the population, but understand that we have to tell the truth. No more sweeping dust under the rug. No more. No more.